Left to the road, right to the decoy.
Okay.
So we'll be in the pursuit vehicle if somebody was to take a shot.
This week on Kentucky Afield.
Oh, he didn't see us.
We're riding along with conservation officers James Brace.
Said he got out of the car. Stand by. But...
And Robin Martinez.
Now we're headed down this hill because he gave us a complaint that his neighbor has shot two bucks.
To see what a day in the life of a CO is really like. Then.
You ready, checkers? You ready? Let's go.
NFL quarterback Chris Redman and his Hall of Fame father, Bob.
Steady Eddie, baby. You gonna mind me? I'm gonna put him down.
Really love to get outdoors. We're rabbit hunting together in Western Kentucky. It's all next on Kentucky Afield.
Such a pretty fish.
Beautiful.
This pond is plumb loaded with frogs.
They're everywhere in here. Yeah, this is a good fish right here. Really good fish.
Come here, girl.
Hey, boy.
That's a big rabbit.
Nice job.
Yes! Yes! My first muskie. First say Leo.
Yeah, look here, it's a keeper.
Here it goes. Boom!
Oh!
Wow, that happened fast.
Hello, and welcome to Kentucky Afield. I'm your host, Chad Miles. Join us as we journey the Commonwealth in search of outdoor adventure. Conservation officers for the Kentucky Department of Fish and Wildlife Resources work tirelessly on land and water to conserve the Commonwealth's natural resources and to ensure great outdoor opportunities for everyone. Last year alone, conservation officers checked more than 50,000 licenses, wrote more than 8,000 citations, and issued thousands of courtesy notices, all to encourage lawful and safe enjoyment of nature. Conservation officers focus on fishing, hunting, trapping, and boating, but sometimes their mission-focused activities uncover other law enforcement concerns. Recently, we rode along with two of the department's newest officers, and as you'll see in this next segment, conservation officers never know what they'll encounter in the line of duty.
This is my first time doing a deer decoy. I've been working with the department since August 16th of last year, 2019. It takes about a year to go through the training process. After that, like I said, I've been out of my own for about 4 months.
Left to the road, right to the decoy.
Okay.
So we'll be in the pursuit vehicle. If somebody was to take a shot, we'll be the first person to make contact. And then we'll have two officers down here managing the decoys, and we'll have radio contact for them.
The reason we set these decoys, we want to keep all the hunters safe. And if somebody's shooting from the roadway, they don't know what's behind the target or where other hunters are. They don't know anything about the property. So we try to set this decoy up and set it in a safe manner. So if somebody does shoot from the road, then it's in a more controlled environment and we can address the issues and hopefully they will not do that again.
My name is Rob Martinez. I'm a conservation officer. I've been employed since last August, but got out working by myself about 5 months ago. So we have a woman who has claimed landowner until they checked a buck in. She doesn't own property in Hart County, and she only checks in bucks. We're thinking that one of her sons is using her to telecheck a buck in so that he's able to kill two bucks a year, his and then the one she telechecks. So we're gonna go talk to her and see if we can get the story straight.
I'm Officer Fisher with the Kentucky Department of Fish and Wildlife. I've been on 5 years. We're riding with Officer Martinez today. Officer Martinez has been on about 6 months. She's one of our newer officers, very capable, but in case we come across something that requires two officers, that's why we're riding along today. We don't have assigned partners, but we do enjoy riding with each other quite a bit, you know, all conservation officers.
Officer Fisher is going to be doing the contact. I'm going to be a cover officer.
Karen, I'm Officer Fisher with the Department of Fish and Wildlife. Uh-huh. We just had a few questions for you.
Yes, sir.
About a deer that you killed this year. Did you kill a buck this year?
No. I don't even know how to use a gun.
Do you know Nathan?
Yeah.
Did he telecheck a deer under you?
He might have. I don't know.
Because it says that you've checked in a deer.
Yeah.
And you've actually checked in about six of them.
So now it says, now this is over the, you know, in the last 10 years, it says you've checked in 6 bucks. You're telling me you don't know how to even operate a firearm. So clearly something's wrong. Nathan would have had to get your social security number in order to check in your deer.
He let me have one deer.
He asked for your social security number to check in a deer so that way he can give you that deer? Mm-hmm. Okay. We just conducted our interview and we did confirm that the individual that checked in the deer had nothing to do with that deer at all. She didn't kill the deer. She states that she doesn't even know how to operate a firearm. She did tell us who killed the deer and told us where we could find him. So we're gonna go make contact with that individual now.
So right now we're just sitting, still waiting. Had a few cars pass, probably, 10 or so. A couple slow down and actually look out the window and everything and got the heart beating a little bit, so.
Oh, he didn't see us.
That might be that same truck too, though. I'm sorry.
Coming back. Dropped off his trailer, coming back quick.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Might be on something.
Something.
Right now, we're headed to Freeman Lake to do some compliance checks real fast since we're in the area. After this, we're hoping we can go make contact with the individual who's checking in the deer for the woman we just interviewed. Had any luck?
Come on, hand me your backpack there, bud. You got any fish in here?
No.
You mind if I take a look real quick? Is that what you just threw out over here? Was your marijuana was in this bag?
No.
All right. Is that what's in here?
What it was in there.
Yeah.
Officer Fisher, as we were approaching, thought he saw this person throw something in the water once he saw us. So we basically just asked for consent to search his backpack to make sure there was nothing illegal. We did find a tube that was holding some marijuana, so there's nothing in it, but Officer Fisher is going to go ahead and make him throw it away so we know he doesn't have it on him anymore.
She stopped. Said he got out of the car, stand by, but we'll see. Still just looking. It's still sitting, looking at the two deer out in the field, our two deer decoys, and we're just waiting for that, possible gunshot. It's a big waiting game right now.
This guy had his kid walking out in the field, so we went down and told him to get something off, but he wasn't right out into the field. He was climbing the fence into the ditch.
Sounding like a guy dropped his son off to go look at the deer or something.
Kid sneaking up on the deer. People try to sneak up on the deer, try to take pictures of it, video it. But ultimately, it tells them what's going on and the word will get out now. So we're probably going to have to call it shortly.
Now we're going to make contact with the nephew of the individual that we talked to earlier about him killing more deer than he's legally allowed to, but he hasn't telechecked any this year, and we know that he's killed some, so we're just gonna go talk to him about that. Good, how are you?
All right.
I was looking for Nathan.
Hey, you don't live here.
You know anybody
by that name? Yeah, what's up?
That was the address that the nephew from before has on our database. He was not there, and the dad informed us that he doesn't live there. He lives in Horse Cave.
Down the other side of Horse Cave.
Okay.
Cave City, Horse Cave in between. Mm-hmm.
So we got a phone number from him for his son. Right now we're headed down this hill because he gave us a complaint that his neighbor has shot 2 bucks.
He shot 2 deer, 2 10 points I know of, that he shot with crossbow, no broadheads on, arrow stuck in his hip, crossbow arrow. He's over now shooting a pistol over a while ago.
Okay, how do we get back there?
Just follow the road. You'll see, top of the hill, you see 2 roads split off. Go to the left one, the dirt path road. Go over the hill, he lives in a barn down there.
Okay.
Stays screwed up on that meth all the time.
Uh-huh.
That's the problem we've been having this year.
Uh-huh.
That's why we ain't seeing no f***ing deer.
So we're gonna go talk to him real quick and see if we can get a confession.
We just finished wrapping up that deer decoy down in an undisclosed location here in Kentucky. And now we're just headed back out in the field, gonna check some hunters possibly and see what we come up with, respond to calls from post area. That's our radio system. See a fishing magazine back there, so they gotta be fishing. Somebody's definitely down there doing something, so we'll go check it out real quick. I'm doing good, how are you doing? That's good to hear, good deal. Well, I guess I'll check you real quick.
That's
problem.
Just want to look at it right there. Just make sure you got it. We got the COVID going on and everything. Awesome. Good deal. Have you caught anything up here?
No, sir. Nothing. No, sir. Like I say, just got here maybe about 10 minutes ago.
Gotcha. Sounds good. Well, good luck to you.
Yes, sir.
He got him something. Good, good. Is that a crappie?
So right now we're at the end of this road that we got a complaint about. When we tried to make contact with the person, we found a lot of marijuana plants. We're trying to get deputies or a couple troopers down here to back us up. We might be having to get a search warrant for the property.
I'm thinking the guy's probably in this house. He's just not coming to the door. There's no windows. It's just an old barn that's been converted into a house. It's got probably 150, 250 marijuana plants hanging from it. There's only one door to the barn, so if he comes out, he's got to come out through me.
Now it's just a waiting game. This is the problem with being a conservation officer. We're so rural, we're so far out. Our unit that's responding is 1 hour from us. So we'll wait, we'll see if we can't make contact. Maybe this individual's out walking his property.
As game wardens, you know, when we're driving these back roads, trying to find hunting camps, conducting investigations, things like that, you know, it's pretty common for us to come across something other than fish and wildlife, you know, outside of 150, 235. And this is a prime example.
So one of the KSP guys showed up and then a city or a county deputy, they're walking around the property seeing if they can find anything else. And I'm gonna stand here on point with this door in case anybody comes out so that I can make contact.
19, 20, 21, 22, 23, oh, a bird. 24, 25, 26.
Okay, what is that?
That is hemp. I have a legal license. There was supposed to be a license hanging on the door.
Okay, I didn't see the license. Do you have your license?
I have it right here on the inside of my truck.
Okay, yep.
You can grab it.
Okay, yep, too. Yep.
Yeah, there's a boy that works with me. Uh-huh. His name is Shalen. I suspect that's where all this is coming from. I know that he has a wife. Him and his wife fight a lot. And I come down here to go to work a lot, and then he'll just be in the barn.
Could be a license right there on the right-hand side.
Shalen,
if you're in here, let us know. State police, let us see your hand. Originally, we got a complaint that there was an individual that was residing at this barn behind me that had killed two bucks this year with a bow without broadheads on it. So we came down here to do a knock and talk. Nobody was here, but when we got here in plain view, we saw a bunch of plants hanging that we weren't aware whether they were marijuana or hemp plants. The individual was not in the building, but while inside, we did find marijuana and then drug paraphernalia for meth. We ran the individual. He ended up being a convicted felon, and there were also guns inside. The owner of the building said that he was unaware of any of it. The guns were not his, so we seized all the paraphernalia, the marijuana, and the firearm so that in case the person comes back, he doesn't have access to any of that considering he's a felon. One of my favorite things about this job is I go every single day and never know what I'm gonna get into. Some days I do nothing but compliance checks or fishing license or hunting. And then other days you roll into stuff like this. You know, we could have potentially come across a felon with firearms today that could have wanted to hurt us. Luckily, nobody was here, but that's one of the things I love about this job is you never know what you're gonna get into. It kind of keeps you on your toes and it makes you enjoy the job more.
Located 9 miles south of Richmond off of Highway 421 is Miller Welch Wildlife Management Area. This WMA is 1,847 acres with over half being made up of fields. The remainder is great forest for hunting and multiple small ponds for awesome channel catfish, bluegill, and largemouth bass fishing. Miller Welch is commonly known for its great trap and skeet shooting ranges. trap and skeet shooting facilities are operated by local clubs and open to the public seasonally for nominal fees. Contact the WMA office for current schedule and pricing. This WMA provides lots of open land pastures for bird dog training, field trials, hiking, and birding. Hunting opportunities are also available for deer archery, wild turkey, squirrel, and dove. A single projectile tube shooting range is also available Tuesday through Sunday and closes at sunset. This WMA also offers a 30-station woodland archery course and a 30-yard static range. Remember that wildlife management area users must abide by Kentucky hunting, trapping, and fishing regulations. Also keep in mind that regulations on WMAs often differ from statewide regulations, so be sure to review the hunting guide or website for the specific WMA that you are hunting. For more information about this WMA or the latest regulations and restrictions that pertain to it, visit our website at fw.ky.gov or call 1-800-858-1549. Recently, we traveled to Western Kentucky to do a little rabbit hunting with a former NFL quarterback and his dad, who is a Kentucky High School Athletic Association Hall of Fame coach. You ready, checkers? You ready? Let's go. We headed to Western Kentucky for a rabbit hunt. We're out here with the Redman family here in Livingston County. They brought some friends. We got a lot of good looking property. 5 or 6 dogs on the ground. Should be a great day. I tell you what, we're having a blast with these guys, talking football, talking about old friendships, and chasing bunnies. It doesn't get any better than that. Hunt them up, hunt them up.
There he is.
Did you get him, Chris?
Yeah.
That's him. There he is. Good job. Good boy.
Hey, Chris, show me that rabbit. You got it? All right. Good job.
Yeah.
Okay, dog's got him running right there. There he is. There's a lot of rabbits in here. They're on another one right now, so... we're gonna kill a few this morning. Gonna be a good hunt today.
You had a stint in Baltimore.
Yeah.
You were there for a while. Actually, was on Super Bowl winning team.
My rookie year. That was a lot of fun.
I bet.
I got some hunting in there too. The Eastern Shore is pretty good hunting. That's what I was gonna ask you.
So did you get to hunt on each of your stops? I mean.
I make myself hunt. I like it so much and learn so much.
So you were there for how many seasons?
4 years in Baltimore. Then I had a couple surgeries. I was out for 2 years and finished my career in Atlanta, which is not a bad place to hunt either. And a lot of good fishing lakes there too.
Yeah, oh, that's great. So how many seasons were you there in Atlanta?
Five seasons in Atlanta. Played till I was 35, and so that's a long career. And yeah. My body's kind of starting to feel a little bit now, but I wouldn't trade it for anything. It was a lot of fun. And we better get ready.
Oh, there he is. Hey, nice rabbit. We called it. Got him out of that woods, came up the little creek bed right here. So, hey, sounds like they're on another one over there.
That rabbit was slipping. Wasn't running, easing through the woods, sitting right there. That was a really easy shot for a rabbit hunter. But I want to reward the dogs. They jumped that rabbit and ran it all the way down about 100 and something yards away and pushed it right back here to us. That was fun. Come on, bring it here. Come on, good job. Bring it here. Let me have it. Nope. That'll be a good one for the skillet. All right, you guys ready for another? Let's go find another one.
My father was a hunter. He was a rabbit hunter. Got me into it at a very, very early age. And his football players are the one that they gave him this gun when he got out of coaching. He coached at Durrett High School.
all his football players pitched in and bought him his shotgun when he decided to retire. This was his stock, and I put my barrel on his stock so I could kind of keep old Pappy with me. Every time we go rabbit hunting, well, he still goes along, and he was quite a man. Oh, here you come. Here you come.
Yeah.
Nice shot.
Yeah.
Did. Good dog. Good dog. Good dog. What'd Pappy say? Steady Eddie, baby.
I tell you what, I about gave up on the dogs on that one, but they did. That rabbit.
They didn't give up, did they? Shot their pops.
My father, last time we took him hunting. Got him up on a hay bale. He was in the 70s. He killed his limit. We all hollered at him and said, hey, steady Eddie, baby. You good to mind me? I'm going to put him down. Pop her on the nose. You'll get her. There you go.
Nice shot.
Thanks, Coach. I appreciate that.
Man, that was great.
Is that the old blind hog get an acorn syndrome?
Hey, I saw that. You went straight up, nice and steady. I even saw you. I heard you go, here it is. And I waited and waited and waited. You just let it get in range and finish it off.
That's what you got to do, shoot them up front.
You shot that like it was a single shot.
That's the idea, man. Get them on the ground.
And I about give up on them. And lo and behold, they ran it right back out to us.
They're doing a good job, you know, staying with it. After they make the lose or whatever, they're hanging. If that rabbit moves a little bit, they're picking up that scent and going again. That was good. That was a good run.
It's interesting, as thick as this is, you would think that our percentages would be much lower. We're not jumping a ton of rabbits, but we're staying busy, and we're getting a high percentage of what we're
jumping. That's very true. That's very true.
I say we get another one.
Let's do it, man.
Nice
I'm all over it.
One of my favorite things to do is take a guy that's never been in the woods or been rabbit hunting and get him out there, and it's a new world. You know, I took Matt Ryan out for the first time deer hunting, and he's from Philadelphia, never did it. Yeah. He just absolutely loved it, so it's...
You took Michael Bush on his first.
Michael Bush got his first turkey this spring, and I just think it's a fun thing to get guys out and experience it.
Oh yeah,
it's one of my favorite things to do. The more guys get out here and see that, hey man, this is a fun lifestyle, and you can get addicted to it really quick.
Hey, hold up.
Did you jump one?
I either just jumped one right here, or I'm looking for waiting for a dog. It's right here. Here it is. Coming to you. Right here. May go right between you. Nope. Here you go, Josie. Coming to you, Mr. Redman.
Dad, behind you. He went right between us. There he is right there.
Got it?
Yeah.
They're going to finish it out. They're coming right to it.
There he is. That's him. That's him. Good boy. That's a good Josie. That's a good Josie. Good Josie. We got him.
All right. That's a good race. Thanks for jumping them.
Hey. I love watching those dogs. They got together and got super excited and pushed that rabbit through here, between it.
Tight little circles today, aren't they?
Yes.
Yeah, that's great.
Well, I think that they know they don't want to cross that cornfield. Well, I really appreciate you guys having us out to do a rabbit hunt.
That was fun. We ran a lot of rabbits today.
That's kind of what it's about. Sometimes you just find time to get out, and getting out and doing this with family, it just doesn't get any better.
No better than that. There's no place I'd rather be out here listening to the dogs with my dad, and it's a great, great afternoon, and it's a lot of fun hunting with you, too.
Now let's check in and see who else has been out having fun in this week's Ones That Didn't Get Away.
Here we have Jerry and Weston Miller and Hoss Williamson with a load of bunnies that were taken in Graves County. Nice job. Abel Fields knows where to find winter fun. That's at Otter Creek catching rainbow trout. Check out these great looking crappie with Harper Purnell that were caught in Green River Lake. Nice fish. Check out this beautiful picture of Mackenzie Wallace and her first goose that she took in McCracken County. Nice job.
Looks like fishing brings a smile to Emmett Morey of California, Kentucky, and he caught a nice crappie in a farm pond. Wintertime conditions doesn't scare Aiden Rudd away as he caught this nice largemouth bass in his grandpa's farm pond in Kenton County. Check out Claire Flood's first deer ever. This deer is over 200 inches, no matter how you measure it. Great deer. Well, it's that time of year again. It's time for the annual Spring Fishing Call-In Show. Please join us live on Facebook this Tuesday night, February the 16th at 7 o'clock Eastern. And remember, hunting and fishing on private property is a privilege. Always ask permission and thank the landowner. Until next week, I'm your host, Chad Miles, and I hope to see you in the woods or on the water.